So the.
Better this way?
Yeah.
So the next speaker is Rocío Páez from the Academy of Athens, and she will talk us about Necrochef instability. You have 20 minutes.
Well, actually, the new title of the presentation, which changed a little with respect to the abstract, is a fully predictive model for amyloid diffusion. And at this point, I have to make a disclaimer, because amyloid diffusion is a very specific term that refers to a mechanism, something that happens in a certain way. Here, we do not prove that the mechanism, this particular mechanism, is taking place, but we show evidence of something. So, well, you will analyze the evidence at the end of the talk, and you will decide if it looks like amyloid diffusion or not, but technically we don't prove it, so I wanted to make the disclaimer before. So, this is working collaboration with Massimiliano Woodson and Christoph Dimiopoulos. And yes, and after 4 years of working on classical celestial mechanics, my first talk in CELMEC is about weakly chaotic Hamiltonian systems, but okay, this happens. So, what I'm going to discuss today, since we cannot prove exactly this amyloid diffusion, I will call it a slow diffusion of reactions. The key point is this: if you have a system that has a wave of resonance of certain, let's say, number of degrees of freedom, and you can describe the system, let's say, by a mean of a wave of resonances, you will have some slow chaotic diffusion. If it is very slow, or it is a little faster, if it is truly amyloid diffusion or it is not, this is a different topic, but you will have. And the point of this is trying to characterize how this takes place. I mean, you will have to take care of. In celestial mechanics, there are several different fields where this appears, in particular in planetary system dynamics, like the secular evolution of planets, or the dynamics of the small bodies. But in every nonlinear system beyond celestial mechanics, we can have similar phenomena. For you to look like, more or less how it is, these are very simple cases of actually 4D symplectic mapping, that they show some cases of chaotic diffusion. What you see here are essentially FLI maps, fuzzy Lyapunov indicator maps that measure stability. You see the resonances. And what you have here in black, and here very little in red, and here a little bigger, are orbits that are moving along this web of resonances. They start here, over here. I think this is a set, as an ensemble of initial conditions that they are propagating in time. And we can see that they go all along the web of resonances. This is a work of Massimiliano with Elena Lega and Claude Frochlet on a 4D symplectic map. And this is, let's say, the resolution of very difficult to see now. This is in red, a small piece here. This is a single orbit that propagates all along the resonant web. And this is a relic of my computer because it belongs to my master thesis. The point is, if you have resonant webs, the things eventually will diffuse. And the idea is to understand how this happens, or in the case that there is nothing that can help you how it happens, to understand how much it will happen, to quantify this effect. Well, this is the problem with the slow diffusion. It's very difficult to see. Why? We have orbits in the separatrix region, okay? They are chaotic orbits that they are diffuse, otherwise they will not diffuse. So, why this is difficult to see? We will consider initially, otherwise I cannot move. Now it's better. Okay, so we will compute the action, okay? We have a system describing action. Actually, the previous plot were referring to, let's say, the two actions space. This is why we have the resonance as lines. So, if we compute what happened with the action then, we will see something like this plot. Something that moves more or less constant with a lot of noise. If the diffusion is truly slow, and it's truly small, no matter if it is taking place or not, inside here, I will not see it. Okay? It will be hidden in all the noise that the action has. So, the only way, or one of the ways to see it, is try to remove all this noise. There is a mechanism developed, let's say, some years ago, in order to show if there is a small diffusion hidden there or not. What do? We take, let's say, our Hamiltonian, and we normalize, we compute a resonant normal form, up to optimal order. I will be a little more specific on this later on, but the point is that you can pass from something that looks like this in a different set of variables that clearly represent better that your action starts very small, this is the, let's say the delta of the action, and it starts growing in time. I want you to compare, if you can see, they are very small, the orders of magnitude of the two curves. This is 10 to the minus 6, this is 10 to the minus 9. So clearly, this curve, it will be, let's say, a completely straight line here. But if we can remove that deformation, we can see that it's truly there. On the other hand, let's say the normal form of fractions allow to determine how much could be this diffusion. Let's say, do we have a quantity, a number associated with this effect? And this can be done by comparing, actually, it's a work that has done, well, Christos, with respect to some numerical estimation of diffusion coefficient done by Lega, Lutz, and Froschlet some years before, that there is a correlation between the coefficient of diffusion, let's say how much my orb is dispersed in the action space, and the optimal remainder that I will define later on. Okay, this curve looks very nice, like all the points computed numerically fit very well with a straight line, but the point is that it's a log-log scheme, so there are some, let's say, order of magnitude key in there. What we will try to do today is emphasize or try to evidence this phenomena, but in a little more accurate way, with estimations that are a little more accurate. So, what we do is we consider an example, because since this phenomenon of slow diffusion is not proved to happen in every general system, in some cases when there is no theorem, let's say, sustaining that this phenomenon happens, we have to go case by case. So we take a specific Hamiltonian that depends essentially on three axes and three angles, and that has a peculiarity to me. If we consider this as a space of actions, in half of the upper half of the space, this Hamiltonian is quasi-convex. And in the lower half, it's a thick knot convex. Okay? If you want to, well, want to check how are the resonance that they may be taking place here, you will see that of the three actions, the third one playing a role, linear dependence, so the formula, the resonant condition between that will give essentially a position of the actions, depends on the other two and has this shape here. This is an FLI map. It's like the one that I showed before, but in a Hamiltonian system, not in a pumping. And you can see that the resonance has this shape, some of them, well, there are others that are very thin also, in the opposite direction, and things cross. Okay, we want to study what happened with diffusion. So what eventually we will do is to take initial conditions in a resonance and to study what happened, to see if we can quantify this, and then to predict this number that we obtain numerically, okay? In particular, we will focus in the one-to-one resonance. This means that the relation K1 and K2 is going to be equal to 1, is the most conspicuous resonance that appears. And in a certain point that is more or less located here, which is, let's say, relatively arbitrary, but in the steep region of the mapping. Okay? Well, if we look a little closer, what we will have, let's say, this is a section of the previous FLI. It's a true FLI, although it has some, let's say, scratch on top. And this is the point that I was mentioning before. How do we study what happens here in the neighborhood of these points? We pass to resonant variables, okay? We will transform our actions, our previous action, A1, A2, and A3, and this phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3 here, in resonant and adiabatic actions, and in a resonant angle and fast angle. This will allow to refer the Hamiltonian, essentially in the neighborhood of this point, when we evaluate about this point. And then, we can measure what happens, instead of the original variables, in the fast, let's say in the resonant action and the fast action, okay? For you to understand more or less what we are going to see in the future, the diffusion will take place along the lines of the resonance, let's say of the separatrix of the resonance. That are these two slightly chaotic lines that we see here, and they are pointing with these red arrows. So the diffusion will go in that direction. Let's say after the definition of new variables, we will see that there are the so-called planes of uplift, defining like these two lines and all the parallel lines to those. And my new actions, F and S, are going to be respect, let's say with the distance, sorry, F is going to be referred with the distance to this, the plane of uplift with respect to the initial one. And well, the S is the original action, let's say the one that jumps with the pendulum, let's say from one to the other along the separatist resonance. This is just to keep an idea in mind of what is going on. The point is, we have the, our new variables. If we normalize, we compute the normal form of the Hamiltonian, and we have the transformation to the normalized variables in our pocket. And then we compute orbits, numerical orbits. We put in the Hamiltonian, we integrate numerically. This gives me a file with the orbit. Okay? If I don't do anything with those variables, what I will see is the noise that I have shown in the previous plots. With, there is all the information included there. But if I transform that quantity in normalized, in my new normalized variables, what we will see is something like that. You see, this is the variation of f, of my first action, f1. And if we integrate a big set of orbits, I think here there are 100 in gray, we will see that some of them start, sorry, all of them start at zero, and then some of them producing some jump, up and down. What is this? It's, let's say, our orbits technically diffusing. It's what was hidden in the previous plot. So, we compute several cases of these orbits. They were, let's say, random sets of a few hundreds of orbits. And we were seeing that some of them were faster or were diffusing more in time than the others. Most of them, you see that they are kind of accumulating here. They were jumping a little and maybe returning or making a very small jump and so on. Some of them were jumping higher. This is the largest drift that we can see. And technically, they are the orbits that are diffusing faster, let's say. In less time, they are going farther. Okay, sorry. This is our numerical result. And this is what we see. But what we want to do is to characterize this. Can we predict this? Can we obtain a result after some analytical study that can estimate what is happening a priori without making a numerical computation? Well, for doing so, there is a very classical technique. We have Hamiltonian, like ours. It's nice if I give an example, but this is going to be rather general. And what we do is to compute the optimal normalization. And I will be a little more specific here on what we do. We have the original variables. We transform to the resonant and the slow actions and the resonant and the fast angles. And what we will get is that our Hamiltonian acquires the shape of, okay, the original integrable part that we have here with the transform variables. A normal form that depends on the actions and only on the resonant angle, and a remainder. So the normalization is called optimal because what I do is I generate this after a certain amount of steps that guarantees that this remainder is the smallest. Let's say this process is not converging. So if I continue normalizing, my remainder goes down and at some point stop going down. Let's say stop being small and it starts rising up. So essentially everything diverges. What we do is we stop there. When it is small, we stop. When it's small as possible, we stop. We can see that here, that the normal form, this part, is the one that do not depends, let's say, on the fast angles. So if we want to consider how much it changed the actions here, the action f1 and f2, since the conjugate angle do not appear, this means that these are integral of motion for this part, for the first two terms. In other words, if I want to compute how much the action varies in time, the only part that is contributing is the remainder. And since my remainder is optimal, when I want to compute this quantity, the one that will have less noise altogether. This is why we keep the, say, the optimal normalization. If you want to know more or less about the shape, depending on the variable, but essentially it depends on the angles, say, complex exponential due to their numbers. So, as I say, if you want to compute the variation, essentially what you have to integrate is all these terms. Okay? Now, how do we do this? We use the Melnikov approach. Essentially, what Melnikov is suggesting is, okay, you are in the separatrix because the orbit that are diffusing, you take the unperturbed separatrix solution that you get from the normal form, you replace it, you integrate. And this gives a certain delta f. Okay, if you do this and you solve what remains in that integral, what you get is that essentially, let's say the variation that will depends on the form of the separatrix solution, and you have an exponential that depends on a certain phase that we call theta. Okay? Depending on how it is theta, that depends on all the parameters of the system, including the numbers of the harmonics of every specific term, let's say this integral will contribute or not, let's say greatly or not, to the total shunt in axis. Okay? So we should check how it is theta in order to a priori, let's say, estimate what will happen with this. Okay, so far so good. The point is that the normalization process, the normalization algorithm, up to optimal reminders gives, let's say, this function is a series that we truncate, but to keep everything more or less accurately, let's say, not to keep very few terms, your reminder has something like 40 million terms. So to solve this integral for 40 million terms for every orbit to determine the shunting is well, not impossible to do, but it will take a lot of time. And probably, let's say, it's not necessary. And this is where are we going. Because what we will see is that, as I said before, all the content, or most of the content, is due in what happened with this function, theta. Sorry if I didn't say before, sigma is the resonant angle, okay? When we made the transformation to resonant quantities, sigma is the angle. So, what will happen then? Depending on the, let's say, on what happened exactly with this function, this integral will contribute more or less. We have, of all the 40 million terms, that we can distribute the behavior in three cases. One is that theta of sigma is a function, let's say, that moves quite fast, let's say, with respect to sigma. This means that the derivative is greater than a certain quantity that for the moment is arbitrary. Okay? How will be the behavior of this integral if this is what happens? We have the integral of something that varies quite fast in time. So essentially, you have something that oscillates fast. And when you integrate in the whole space of the separatrix over something that oscillates fast, essentially, you get nothing. So these terms do not give anything. Fortunately, these are most of the terms of the remainder. Of the 40 million, these are probably the 99.9%. There are other two cases. One is that this space contains, let's say, properly speaking, a point where, let's say, the phase becomes stationary. Let's say the derivative of this quantity is equal to zero. Exactly. Like here and here. There is a theorem for that that says that if you have an integral of this type, and you have points that accomplish that, and the rest of the behavior, let's say, is quite fast, as it was happening here, essentially, the overall contribute of this case to the integral will be ruled by what happened in the stationary point. This is the so-called stationary phase theorem or something like that. We were thinking, okay, clearly this is going to give something, probably the case that we have to take care of. But in addition, we have cases that they do not have a true stationary point, but in a certain region, for a certain, let's say, values of sigma that they are not, is not so short, the derivative is quite slow. So it is not stationary, but it is quasi-stationary. At the very beginning, we thought that, okay, probably this is enough for computing the integral because they are important, they are the proper stationary points. But then, when we tried to estimate the integral analytically, we compute the integrals given the solution of this theorem, and we compute the variation on the axes, we see that the things were not happening very nicely because it was giving something like two or three orders of magnitude of our numerical results. That you can say, okay, they are not necessarily conclusive, but we computed many numerical orbits and we were truly, let's say, lower. So we say clearly there is something that we are forgetting. And the truth is that when we consider the two terms, the one with the stationary points and the one that was in the quasi-stationary approximation, we got that, let's say, the contributions, if we consider all the terms of one type and the other terms of the other type, were very similar but opposed. So when one was going up in a very magnitude, let's say producing a sham going upwards, the other part was going making a sham that goes going downwards, more or less in the same quantity, quite close. And if you sum them, you get with something very smaller that has some small variations. It's not exactly, let's say, zero. What you have here is for a specific case that we compute the sham by this way, and this is the blue curve that is exactly this curve, plotted here but in much smaller scale. You can see that we pass from 1.6 10 to the minus 5 to 1.7 10 to the minus 7. What we did here is, let's say, the green points is the numerical integrated orbit. So what we do is just to summarize, because probably this is the important part of the thing. On one side, we have our Hamiltonian, the equations of motion, we integrate numerically, we obtain orbits for the different examples. Certain initial condition, let's say, evolves in time, and this, in particular, the one that produces the biggest jump, is this one. On the other hand, we have our integral, the Melnikov one, computed only for the terms that are accomplishing the second and the third condition, that are a few thousand of all the 40 million that we have in the remainder. And the element that we get is this. So it is not only going fine up, let's say, up to the level of the order of magnitude, but also is reproducing the upper down jumps that we get in the numerical case. So we repeat this for several cases. What you have here, I think I didn't say it before, but all the previous cases were for the Hamiltonian that showed the beginning with epsilon equal to 0.001, which is this case. But we have done it for lower and higher values of epsilon. This is an example also of the numerical integrated orbits. And you can see in red, well, in gray is all the whole set. In red is the numerical orbit. And in blue and in black, we have, let's say, our analytical estimation. It's an analytical estimation of this. That reproduces, let's say, quite well, I would say, what happened in the numerical case. The biggest disagreement that we have doing this with respect to the numerical sham is two. Let's say we compute, I think for the worst case, with 10 to 0.008. Our numerical sham, I think, is the half of what we estimate. In all the rest, it's even better. While previous estimates were, let's say, much more rough altogether. For instance, just to emphasize here, to compare with what happened of the so-called, let's say, Nekrasov estimate for this kind of diffusion, that it was given, this is computed by taking the derivative of remainder with respect to the fast angle, sorry, times the time that takes to produce the jump. This is an estimation given by Nekrasov. When you compute this, you see that you obtain a certain order of magnitude jump. This is the numerical one, this is the third column. And this is our new estimate. That, let's say, is truly reducing the variation that we get from analytical estimates. Well, just to emphasize here that the terms that we are considered for the analytical iteration are very few with respect to the total remainder, because this is a big change. And finally, and with this I'm closing, I think I am fine on time, I will show you a plot that we like very much, which is, it's funny, because whenever we were discussing, okay, if this truly shows some features of Arnold diffusion, I say, yeah, yeah, very much. One of my collaborators said that this was the best plot, and the other one said that this was the best plot, because truly we are looking for different things. But what we can see here, this is one of the orbits that this was computed in, with the method that I said before. We have a big set of numerical orbits propagated, and we are always taking the one that propagates faster, let's say, or actually that diffuse the most. And this one in particular, we follow it for several jumps. Continuous jumping, continuous jumping, continuous jumping. Of course, this is plotted in the normalized variables, otherwise, pure noise. If we remove the noise, we see this. And then, when you go to compute to plot what happens in the resonant variables of that, you see an orbit that starts over here and starts making the separatrix and going farther away. This is a numerical integration. And if you were paying attention in the first talk of Professor Seara, you see a very similar plot to this, which is actually, I think, is a plot of Professor Rafael de Llave, that clearly what I think, I believe he was trying to sketch was this phenomenon. But this is human. We have a lot of that is doing this. So I don't have conclusions because essentially we're repeating the last slide that we have, let's say, a analytical mechanism that can reproduce at that level the numerical interaction, the numerical diffusion seen in orbits. And the truth is that we don't need the whole reminder, we need the normalization, otherwise we don't see anything. But we don't need the whole reminder for estimating that. So that's it. Questions?
Question, comment? Yes.
Yeah, do you have an understanding of this quasi cancellation in the terms of group 2 and the terms of group 3?
Exactly.
Are they related to the same amount?
Exactly. Exactly, myself, exactly no, because I was computing numerically, but I do know that Christos was chasing these terms, Because, I mean, the one that are quasi stationary, the one that are stationary, you just find it. I mean, you go to see the theorem, you see what are the points that truly have this, let's say, the zero derivative, and the other ones, let's say, you just neglect. The quasi stationary are more or less arbitrary. So essentially, you have to check, not term by term, because there are 40 million, but some of these terms, which one could be the one that were producing some cancellation. It was a lot of trial and error. But we were checking that since our numerical iteration was much slower, which could be, let's say, for every stationary term, which could be the term that we were not considering that could produce a similar sham but canceling the other one. So it was up and off. There is a relation, I think, of the harmonics. Let's say for certain stationary term, not any randomly speaking quasi stationary is going to cancel that. But now I don't recall exactly what is the relation, but for sure there is.
Okay, so we are short of time. We thank the speaker.